are things that young children already know from a very, very early age, and it's knowledge that we can build on in our classrooms. So one way that I've thought about doing this for some of the teachers I've worked with is through the use of translingual mentor texts, which translingualism also was a term that came up in the last presentation. And translingual mentor texts, some of you may be familiar with, are texts written by bilingual authors that engage in the strategic use of more than one language. So it's not, there are also dual language texts, right, which you can do different things with, the moment that we talk about. The ones that have like English here and the other language here, and it's just a translation. There are tons of things you can do with that, right? But the one I'm interested in are the ones where it's just one text. And in this case, it's written primarily in English, but there's some Spanish that was used by the author. Similar to Enzo Dua, that was an example of a translingual text. Mentor text may not be a term used here in Pennsylvania, it's a guide that the students get out there. A word of caution, texts that seemingly engage in translingual strategies may actually be engaging in mock language. So you have to be careful. And if you're not sure, it's better to ask someone who you think would know. Right? So there could be inauthentic or incorrect uses of languages other than English. So if you see things like Il Problema, Uichibo, even Ankaramba, it may not be the best book. So if you're not sure, and the danger is that they may actually reinforce stereotypes, right? So if you're not familiar with the language and you're not sure, it's always better to ask somebody, hey, is this one that actually has authentic uses of the language? Is it, or is it something that's mocking the language? That's the last thing we want to have to think about. And so just quickly, the outline of the unit. We used the text Abuela, which was a text that was written primarily in English, but the dialogue of Abuela was in Spanish. And Abuela was only referred to as Abuela, which is grandmother. So the first day of the unit was just introducing the students to the book. It was a general read aloud for comprehension that any elementary teacher does when people read aloud the first time. The second day was intended to model a close reading. I don't know if it's a little thing here. It certainly is huge in Pennsylvania. This was the second, well, I'll get to the class, but this was the first time that the students were doing close reading ever. So you'll see it's heavily scaffolded. But then day three was intended to continue to engage in the close reading. Here, the major goal was to help students become aware that the bilingual author, in this particular case, had provided context clues to help non-Spanish speaking readers understand the story. So looking closely at the ways that the author constructed the text to provide those clues was the second day of the close reading. The first day was just looking at the decision to put dialogue in Spanish. And then day four was kind of just a culminating reader's theater, kind of interactive reading of the text. And day five was an open day because, from my experience, teachers don't have time to get through everything. And when I piloted this with the teacher, that actually was a snow day, so day five just ended up being a snow day. It was fun. And I'm happy to share the unit with people if you want it. I'm sure I can send it to you all and you can share it with whoever wants it. And certainly, and I've blogged about it. You can look at my blog to get it too. So I piloted this in Ms. Lopez's class. This was a different class. It's in the same neighborhood. But it was a traditional public school rather than a charter school. But you see the demographics are very similar. The only difference is that this school was 100% economically disadvantaged, which is not uncommon in Philadelphia. So this was the second grade classroom. The teacher was Latina. There were 17 students. Most of the students were seen by the school as officially reading below grade level. And I say that because I don't want people to think that this was the class. Oh, these were the kids that were just the quote smart kids in the school, right? And so of course they can do the things that I'm going to show you they did. No, these were the kids that were not considered the smart kids, right? But because we were using language practices that they were already familiar with, it's resonated with them, right? And they were able to engage with it. So I have a sometimes so I can. This was to give you a sense of what the close reading looked like. This is Ms. Lopez on the second day of close reading, where she's trying to model a think aloud about how the author provided clues to the readers.
Que es lindo, says Abuela. I know what she means. I think the park. So, I'm going to think of. In Spanish, abuela.
Lindo. And read it. In Spanish, abuela said el parque es lindo. But then, Arthur Doros, the author, he puts in here, I think the park is beautiful too. So that's a clue for me. If I don't know what el parque es lindo means, I still understand what Abuela is saying because he wrote, I think the park is beautiful too. So Arthur Dorras is translating here for us. You see how he did that? But to provide some context, at the beginning of the lesson was them thinking about a time that they could translate for somebody. And now they're seeing that same exact language practice written in this text. And now they're saying that they're learning, hey, I as a bilingual author can also do this in a text if that's what I choose to do. Right? So it's not sorting things into academic or non-academic. It's saying, hey, you do these really cool things, and you as a bilingual author can also do these really cool things in your writing. Right? And this was the first day of the shared writing, where the first day they were just drawing a picture and labeling it. And you'll see this is Ms. Lopez giving them a sense that they're going to be doing something translatable in the brain.
Because maybe people don't know that's an apple cake, so I'm just going to label it. Apple cake. But you know what? Actually, I don't even call it apple cake. We call it, torta de manzana. Maybe I'll write that.
Yeah, and torta, because torta means different things in different countries. So it doesn't mean cake in every country. But the teacher was from Chile, so it means cake in Chile, but it means like a meat sandwich in other places. So that was an opportunity that the teacher had to explore, but she could have, and it would have been really interesting. And so this was then when Torta de Manzana appears in the instructive text that the teacher is writing as a model the second day of the unit, or the second day of shared writing.
Since I drew about her teaching me how to make a torta de manzana, I need to put that in my story, okay?
She
taught. I'm looking for, this is a tricky word, but this is how you spell it. Taught.
She taught me how to make
when I go
to my
tía's house, she tells me, ¿Niño, me puedes cargar a tu primo bebé, por favor? And I tell her, yes, tía. And my tía says, yes, niño.
and how does it help us to hear those language practices differently than these other terms that are the most common terms used to describe the students. And so I wanted to end just with a quick quote from James Baldwin. Because I think that what I'm suggesting, that my research focuses on Latino communities, Latinx communities, is really something about the issues of language diversity and race and racism in general. And so James Baldwin, in an essay that he wrote, "Black English Isn't a Language, Then Tell Me What Is," argued, "A child cannot be taught by anyone whose demand essentially is that the child repudiate his experience and all that gives him sustenance, and enter a limbo in which he will no longer be black, and in which he knows that he can never become white." And I think that this kind of friendly language policing that I've been challenging us to kind of reflect on, I think does give the unintentional or accidental message to our students that they should repudiate their experiences when they come into our classroom. And I think when we give that message to students, they're not going to then try to take on new identities that we want them to inhabit in class. That we really have to begin and build on the identities, the cultural and linguistic practices of the students, and see those as integral to the work we do, rather than as dichotomous with it. So that said, gracias.